FY21, NHI accelerated the project award activity, and up to Jan 15, 2021, it awarded about 7,600 kilometers of road projects, which is more than double as compared to last year. Despite lockdown in the initial period of current financial year, 8,160 kilometers of road projects were constructed against 7,570 kilometers of the road projects during the same period last year. Since December 2019, government made the fast tag compulsory for all vehicles plying on national highway. There is a steady growth in the toll collection. Barring initial 5 months of FY21, toll collection exceeded pre-COVID level in September 2020. Government has taken various measures to mitigate the impact of lockdown on the EPC contractors, which includes lowering the performance bank guarantee to 3% from 5 to 10%, no earnest money deposit for government projects, extension of timelines by 6 months, and release of performance bank guarantee to the extent of completed projects. However, bank credit to construction and the road sector has not been rising in the manner road projects were getting completed. The credit to the construction and road sector merely grew by 4 to 5% on YoY basis in the past 2 years, mainly due to the issues in the sector with respect to right-of-way, stretch working capital, and the leveraged balance sheet of the contractors and developers. So we remain cautiously optimistic on the sector, and we believe that HAM and the EPC model will remain preferred mode to award projects as compared to toll road projects. However, NHAI's ability to maintain the momentum to award projects largely depends on its ability to maintain leverage, which is possible through the fundraise by way of TOT and InvIT. Although overall toll collection is on the rise due to compulsion of FASTag, however, developers will stay away from toll road projects due to its inherent risk. So therefore, we believe the company with low levered balance sheets, ample unused bank lines, and managing working capital efficiently will benefit going forward.
As far as power sector is concerned, we have seen power demand growth shown sharp improvement since July-August after witnessing double-digit contraction of 25% in April, resulting in lower thermal PLF of 42%, a record low merchant tariff of 2.1 rupees per unit. Positive demand trajectory is continued on the back of higher commercial and industrial segment and retail demand, with a peak demand reaching to a level of 185 gigawatt recently. The PLF rebounded to 53% in December, and so the merchant prices. Going forward, we expect power demand to maintain positive trajectory of 5 to 6% in calendar year 21, which would drive thermal PLF to 55% in financial year 22. Coming on renewable, we have observed that solar tariff continued downward trend and recorded a new low of Rs. 2 per unit in November 20 CK auction. Bidding activity remained stable for solar, with 21 gigawatt of project awarded till September 20, compared to less than a gigawatt in wind. We have observed that wind award impacted due to wind pattern variability, machine availability, and grid containment issues. Going further, we expect that future capacity additions would be largely dominated by solar due to declining tariff and low gestation period, coupled with strong government supporting policies. The next challenge is to reduce intermittencies and availability during peak hours, which can be addressed with 2 to 4 hours of storage. As we all know that thermal is available 24/7, while the same case is not there when the renewable is concerned. With declining battery cost, and electricity cost is expected to come down from 4.2 rupees per unit to 2.9 rupees per unit in the coming decade. We don't foresee any major downgrade in the sector due to better project economics. Needless to mention that most of the operating IPPs in the solar power segment is investment grade category due to strong parentage, PPA tie-up, and lower operating risk. Coming to transmission, as far as transmission sector is concerned, we expect investment of 1.8 trillion rupees in the next 5 years. Credit risk in transmission sector is expected to remain benign due to higher collection efficiency, lower revenue risk, and robust business model. On distribution front, state DISCOMs overdues remain flattish, although total dues remain elevated at around 1,40,000 rupees in October. We expect that losses to remain elevated at around 80,000 crores in FY21 due to higher AT&C losses, although proposed DISCOM privatization would help to curtail losses. Private DISCOMs would continue to perform better than state DISCOMs due to their better operating efficiencies. We have seen that government has announced various schemes to mitigate liquidity stress of DISCOMs, including Atmanirbhar package of 1,20,000 crores. About 42,000 crores is already disbursed under the scheme, which along with further disbursement is expected to liquidity pressures of GenCos. Further, privatization of DISCOM is welcoming step by government. We expect select private players to participate in privatization, and we will remain quite opportunistic for these players given the robust and regulatory business model. Effective implementation of various government announced reforms, mainly DISCOM privatization, smart metering, national tariff policy, Aditya scheme, is expected to largely address the power sector concern, and the sector is expected to see the much needed turnaround. We remain positive on distribution and transmission. Renewable are set to take leap on all front. However, reinforcing the sanity of PPA, timely adoption of tariff, and signing of new PPA still remain key challenges for renewable. As an asset class, we remain opportunistic for transmission and distribution, avoid thermal with large untied capacity, and would prefer solar over wind in renewable segment.
The performance of the auto sector had been muted in the past few years. The industry was suffering from Indian macro slowdown and had to deal with costs and disruptions involved in the BS6 transition. So when the COVID hit the industry, the auto sales took a beating, and lockdown in various parts of the world ensured that the industry was on a standstill. The current situation is that there is a gradual demand revival and sales pickup happening in various segments of the Indian auto industry. The sales data showed that the passenger vehicle segment has recovered to 2019 levels. The two-wheeler category posted 80% plus volumes in November versus the previous year. Tractor sales too exceeded the previous year numbers in July on back of good monsoon and had been strong ever since then. However, the commercial vehicle and three-wheeler category is still some way off and would take some more time to bounce back. On an overall industry basis, there exist surplus capacities at the moment as the industry is still functioning on production levels below the peak production capacities. As such, the need for capacity expansion is limited and cash can be used elsewhere to benefit the industry as a whole. Infrastructure spending for platform improvement and new regulation already has happened to a large extent, and demand revival is a theme that has played out over the past few months. The shift in customer preferences in terms of higher variants in two-wheelers and personal mobility needs due to the ongoing pandemic were also some positives for the industry. Support from the government in the form of the PLI scheme was also a beneficial step, as it will spur the entire ecosystem forward. Our view hence is that the industry's long-term demand drivers are intact, despite the domestic market witnessing a slower pace recovery in some segments. The sector remains structurally strong due to low penetration and improving affordability, and the outlook is positive for the coming year.
Indian telecom industry is largely concentrated between three players who account for about 90% of the market share. Reliance Jio has the highest subscriber market share at 35.3%, followed by Bharti Airtel at 28.7% and Vodafone Idea at 25.4% as per TRAI report. Over the past 3 years, data usage increased significantly from 700 MB to 700 MB per month to 11 to 15 GB per month. And therefore, penetration of 4G connections has become important evaluating tool. RJO's entire subscriber base is on 4G, while Bharti and Vodafone have 52 and 39% 4G connections respectively. According to CRISIL estimate, total number of data subscriber base would reach to 900 million till 2024, and more than 50% would be on 4G and higher technologies. Recently, Bharti and Vodafone Idea approached Supreme Court to seek correction in the AGR assessment order. And if the same is re-evaluated positively, it will benefit significantly for these two players. Meanwhile, Vodafone Idea is in process of raising about 25,000 odd crore from various investors as approved by its board in September 2020. Auction of 5G is expected to take some more time due to various technical, regulatory and commercial limitations. Meanwhile, as per the Ericsson Mobility Report October 2020, by 2026, 5G connections will have market share at about 27%. In our view, sector is positive, with the industry revenue is expected to grow at 15%, mainly on account of increase in tariff and increase in data consumption.
Weakening dollar index, along with strong demand from China, which contribute about 50% of global production and consumption, supported commodity prices in CY20. Higher import and lower export from China, about 32 million ton in calendar year 20, compared to 52 million ton in calendar year 19 and 100 million ton in calendar year 2015, coupled with higher raw material price, mainly iron ore and coking coal, supported international prices in second half of calendar year 20. China export HRC price rose to as high as $700 per ton in December compared to $400 per ton in Feb March 20. Worst of COVID, it seems to be over for steel sector, with all major economies showing improvement in demand, with China remain outlier with a growth of 6% in CY20 versus overall expected demand contraction of 2.5% by WSA. On domestic front, continuous rise in domestic consumption, lower export, 0.5 million ton per month in December quarter versus 1.8 million ton per month in September quarter, and lower supply from secondary market due to lower iron ore availability led to falling steel inventory, causing a massive spike in HRC prices by almost 20,000 rupees per ton in the last 6 months. We expect sharp improvement in EBITDA per ton of steel companies in the first half of CY21 on the back of favorable geographical mix and higher steel prices to be partially offset by increase in iron ore prices and benign coking coal prices. We expect domestic steel price to remain resilient in near term as domestic demand uptick and regional price remain elevated. With demand picking up and supply tightening, domestic iron ore prices will remain strong, while coking coal prices is expected to increase. On non-ferrous front, aluminum price increased sharply in second half of calendar year 20 from $1,500 per ton to about $1,900 per ton due to improved demand from China. Aluminum demand outlook is expected to improve with expected industrial recovery from rest of the world, along with continued improved demand from China, given its thrust on new infrastructure, which is mainly 5G and renewables. Although expected surplus of 3 billion ton in CY21 would restrict any meaningful upside in aluminum price from current level in CY21, we expect that price to soften during second half of CY21 and spreads to moderate. Zinc price also recovered swiftly due to China's strong consumption, China being net importer of zinc from $1,900 per ton to about $2,650 per ton during CY20. We expect that refined zinc market is expected to be in surplus of 0.6 million ton in CY20 versus 0.5 million ton in CY21. We believe that zinc price will remain resilient for near term, although may soften in second half of FY21. We expect that calendar year 21 would be startup deleveraging cycle for steel players and expect that EBITDA to come down to about 3x in FY22 from 4x in FY20 and about 13x in FY16. The similar trend is expected for non-ferrous players, with operating profit to witness healthy increase due to sharp increase in metal prices and prevailing cost structure. As an asset class, we would continue to prefer ferrous over non-ferrous and be selective basis leverage position, raw material integration, liquidity, conversion efficiency, and regional dominance.
FY21 appears to be an exceptional year for the residential real estate market. On the YTD basis, demand is low on account of lockdown in the initial period of the year. Meanwhile, traction in the sales can be seen across various markets post-lockdown is lifted. Residential sales recovered quite sharply in Q3 FY21, registering about 22% growth on quarterly basis across top 8 cities, which account for 3/4 of the total sales on an all-India basis. Most large real estate developers recovered sales touching 80 to 90% of its pre-COVID level. Unsold inventory also showing a reducing trend, and which was about 1135 million square feet in Q1 FY21, reduced to 1090 million square feet in Q3 FY21. Prices across top 8 cities were down just by 0.4% Q1Q in last quarter, continuing the trend of stable prices despite significant YOY decline in the sales. Government has taken various measures to provide relief to this sector, which includes a reduction in stamp duty to 2 to 3% in Maharashtra, Karnataka, offering moratorium, tax cuts, reduction in construction premium, deferral project timelines, and extending liquidity to sector through various government schemes. Our view is positive on the sector, with large developers continue to increase their market share. Affordability segment is expected to perform better. However, price will remain under pressure due to existing inventory overhang. Now, talking about the commercial real estate sector, India's total grade A office space is about 550 million square feet, majorly concentrated in top 7 cities, with occupancy at 86%. The 7 cities account for 95% of total absorption and supply. Bangalore is not just the largest market in India,
but also largest market among the top major cities across world in terms of office space absorption. The commercial RE has been in upcycle during 2014 to 2019 with rising rentals, falling vacancies, consolidation among the developers, and emergence of REITs. Top seven cities are preferred destinations of office space globally as it offers cheaper lease rentals for grade A properties, which is just $1 per square feet per month on an average. Operating cost of full-time employee is more than 80% lower as compared to tier two cities in the US, and availability of highly skilled STEM talent pool. Technology and BFSI sector account for more than 50% of office lease space across the country. Two listed REITs like Embassy and Mindspace showed good collection efficiency at around 98 to 99% during the first two quarters of FY21 during the lockdown period. During three quarters of CY 2020, net absorption and net supply were down by 61% and 35% respectively, mainly on account of lockdown. On overall basis, vacancy is expected to increase due to lower absorption as compared to supply. Meanwhile, we are positive on the sector with large institutional asset owners or aggregators like REITs are expected to benefit due to their sheer size, ability to provide world-class infrastructure, large floor plates, ability to provide big discounts to tenants due to its lower leveraging and professional management. However, on long-term basis, we need to see the trend of work from home as it can impact the commercial real estate market.
So we've seen that post the IL&FS crisis, a majority of NBFCs and HFCs have had increased liquidity buffers. They've ironed a lot of the ALM issues that they've had. They've tightened their lending standards as well as strengthened both their equity capital base as well as increased their diversification on borrowing side. So going into the COVID crisis, both NBFCs and HFCs most definitely better placed than they were 1.5 to 2 years ago. However, performance on the asset side has been more mixed due to sector-specific issues, largely coming from wholesale financiers and a few SME and vehicle financiers. The slew of government measures that were announced post-COVID-19 improved liquidity conditions for all financiers, as well as provided support to end borrowers through schemes and moratoriums throughout the year. In 2021, we expect liquidity conditions to be benign for financiers across the rating curve, with financing being available relatively easily. The shorter end of the curve would continue to be relatively more accommodative for NBFCs, given the huge steepening that has taken place in yield curves. On the asset side, we have seen improving collection trends across asset classes, though it has flattened off late. For HFCs, we see individual mortgages do quite well, with a large share of incremental growth coming through them. Builder portfolios, on the other hand, would lag in terms of asset quality, but mostly due to existing legacy risky books. We continue to project lower growth for other wholesale asset classes, and we expect some asset quality issues to show up in GNPAs this year. Moving on to vehicle financiers, we expected a quick bounce back, which has broadly taken place in 2020 itself. In 2021, there would be an inch up in NPAs, but we don't expect them to have a material impact on any of the major vehicle financiers. Microfinance institutions, on the other hand, will have a mixed experience with larger balance sheets and rural MFIs being able to weather COVID-related costs, but smaller ones with more geographic concentration and having lesser access to finance find it more difficult. Overall, for the sector, we expect credit costs to be similar to that of demonetization levels. MSMEs, on the other hand, entered COVID on a weak footing, and they've had progressively weaker asset quality even before the beginning of the pandemic. We expect NPAs to materialize here, and this could surprise all of us negatively in case strong credit growth as well as economic growth do not come back in 2021.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.